Good morning to all of you. Today we are starting the next unit in the theory of computation. That is, the name of the unit is computational complexity. So in this computational complexity, the important unit we have to discuss the how the complexity is being computed in the computation theory of computation. That we have to see decidability. So what exactly meaning of decidability that we are going to see? Decidable problems concerning regular languages. As all of you know that the meaning of regular languages, the languages which are given by your finite automata, they are called as the regular languages, right? And the context free languages, CFL, they are determined by your pushdown automata, that is PDA. Then decidable problems concerning context free languages, we have to see the decidable problems concerning with the regular languages as well as the with context-free languages also. Then undecidability, halting problem of Turing machine and a Turing recognizable language. In case of our disability, the first topic in the complexity, computational complexity. In the next topic is nothing but the reducibility. In that reducibility, we are going to see the undecidable problems from the language theory. Undecidable problem from the language theory, a simple undecidable problems, that is PCP, and the mapping reducibility. And the last topic from the unit computational complexity is the time complexity, the very important. And this time complexity we require frequently in our algorithm analysis. That is nothing but the how to measure the complexity of an algorithm, the P class problem, examples of the P class problem, the class NP, examples on the problems in NP, NP completeness, NP hard problem. So that we are going to discuss in the time complexity. So we can say that the complexity in the theory of computation, it is based on the 2-3 factor. That is nothing but the decidability, or it is a reducibility, as well as your time complexity, right? Whether it is nothing but the NP P class problem and NP class problem. So and all these topic, all these topics which we are going to discuss in this particular unit, they are provided with a particular theorem. Means there are theorems are given, and we have to prove the theorem with some assumptions or certain fundamental concepts. So let us see the concept of decidability. So how the decidability is defined, or what exactly is the definition of the decidability? So see here. Decidability, if a language is a recursive, then it is called decidable language. So in a very simple word, it is defined that if a language is recursive, then it is called as a decidable language. And if the language is not recursive, then it is called the undecidable language. So just in one line, you have to remember the definition of the decidable language or the decidability means what. If it is a recursive language, then it is a decidable one. If it is a non-recursive language, it is an undecidable one. The class of decidable problems are also called as the solvable problems. Means yes, you can solve these problems, means there are solution exist for such type of problems. And the class of undecidable problems called as unsolvable problems, means the no solution exist for such type of problems, right? So decidability concept in the complexity analysis, or the in case of your computational complexity, tells us that the languages, for example, your regular language, that is RL, your context free language, your context sensitive language. So whatever may be the languages which we studied in our theory of computation, so they can be decidable or they can be either undecidable. So when it can be called as a decidable, if the languages are recursive in nature, then it is called as a decidable one. And if the language is not a recursive, they are undecidable. Also, the decidable problems, they are solvable problems, means algorithms are exist. Solvable problems means there are particular algorithms are exist. So algorithm means what? Algorithm means nothing but a sequence of steps. Means that such particular problems, they can be solved within certain steps. We can follow certain steps, and the problems of the decidable nature, they can be solved within a fixed amount, a fixed number of stages or a fixed number of steps. Whereas in case of unsolvable problems, we do not have any algorithm, any solution to the such type of problems. We cannot solve these such kind of problems here. Getting this point. So now let us go to the next point, the decidability. Decidability problems concerning the regular language. The next very important point, regular languages. As we know that the regular languages, these are the languages given by your finite automata, DFA or NFA. The language defined by your automata, it is called as your regular language. And further, you can also define that the regular expression, RE, the language given by regular expression, it is also called as the regular language. And the grammar which tells the regular language is called as the regular grammar. It's called as the regular language. So regular languages, and it has certain restriction. As already we have discussed that regular grammar, it has certain restriction. It is type 3 grammar, and it has full instruction imposed on the left hand side as well as the right hand side. So the coming to our regular languages, so we have to see the what kind of decidability problems arises with reference to our regular language. Now, the disability problems, the meaning of problems, you don't take it as a problem, or it is actually as it is meaning, that is problem, but it is nothing but the examples. Problems, or we can say that is these are nothing but the case study. More properly or more correctly, we can say that the disability case study with reference to the regular languages, or disability, one can say that disability examples for the regular languages. Means we are going to discuss the various two, three examples for the disability problems or the disability examples with reference to the regular language and with reference to your context-free language, CFL. So let us see one by one. And these problems or these examples or these studies are given in this fixed format are there. They are having theorem. Theorem is given, means a statement is made here. And to this particular statement, we have to prove this theorem, or we have to prove this particular statement. Getting this point? So problems in the disability problems for the regular languages, or the disability problems for the context-free languages, they are problems, means we can say that these are nothing but the case study, or these are nothing but the examples. And these examples, they are in the format that a statement is given, and that statement is called as the theorem. And that theorem is proved with fundamental assumption or fundamental concepts. So let us see each example one by one, each case study one by one. So see here. The disability problems concerning regular language can be understood with the help of following theorems. So theorems are given here. So theorem number one, prove that following decision problems are recursive in nature. So we have to prove that following decision problems are recursive in nature. So problem number one and problem number two. And why we have to prove it is a recursive in nature? Because if the problem is a recursive in nature, then it is a decidable problem and it is a solvable problem. Just now we have seen the definition. Recursive means the decidable problems, or the decidable means the language which are recursive in nature, they are called as a decidable language, and these language in terms, they are also called as a solvable language, right? So we have to prove that the decision problems given here, like two DFAs are equivalent or not. Two DFAs are equivalent or not. This is the first problem statement, and the second, NFA accepts a word or not. This is the second problem statement. So we will see, or we will solve one by one. We have to give the proof to each problem one by one. So let us see first one. And if it is successfully proved that yes, two DFA are equivalent or not, then we can say that they are recursive in nature. And if they are recursive in nature, ultimately they are decidable in nature, or they are solvable in nature. Getting this point? So let us start proof of the first, that is two DFA are equivalent or not. So let us see here. To prove that the given decision problem is recursive, we require a Turing machine. So by the timing, just remember, we require a Turing machine to solve such kind of problem. So Turing machine defined by T into bracket M, which simulates the DFA. So let M1, capital M1 and capital M2 are the two DFA deterministic finite automata. Now consider the Turing machine TM1 and TM2. So two Turing machines are designed, or they are referred here for M1 and M2. Okay. So see here. Obtain set of strings. So first step is to obtain the set of string accepted by Turing machine 1 and rejected by Turing machine 2. So first step is to obtain the set of string that is accepted by Turing machine 1 and rejected by Turing machine 2. That means we have to calculate S1, the set of strings, set of string S1 in such a way that it is accepted by the Turing machine 1, intersection that is rejected by Turing machine 2. So that's why this arrow is given. So that is nothing but the negation of TUM, TM2. That is nothing but the rejected by the Turing machine 2. So we have to obtain the set of string. They are accepted by the M1 and rejected by M2. Again, similarly, obtain the set of string which TM2 accepts and TM1 rejects. That means set of string S2 in a such a way that TM2, these string, they are accepted by your Turing machine 2, whereas intersection, they are rejected by Turing machine 1. So if these two sets are empty, see here, if these two sets are empty, then it shows that LM, the language given by the machine 1 and the language given by machine 2, that is LM2, are equivalent and can be simulated by the Turing machine for the set of languages as language given by language of machine or language of Turing machine, that is equal to LM1 intersection LM2 union LM1 intersection LM2. Means just take these two field and take their union. This is the first S1 and this is the second S1. You are taking S1 here, string S1 and string S2. And if it is a phi, means if it is empty, then definitely we can say that it shows that they are equivalent in nature, right? So this shows that two DFA are equivalent or not is a recursive problem. So what is our problem? What we have to prove? We have to prove that two DFA are equivalent or not is a recursive problem. Means the problem is that, or the example is that, we have to prove the two DFA are equivalent or not is a recursive problem. And by this we have proved that yes, this is a recursive kind of problem. It means it is a decidable problem. Means it is a kind of decidability problem. Getting this point? So next one, and the second proof to the second problem here. So let M be the NFA. Let capital M be the non-deterministic finite automata, and the input word W, which decides if M accepts W. Convert this NFA to DFA. Then run the algorithm for DFA on Turing machine TM. The Turing machine TM accepts W if and only if M reaches to the final state of W. This shows that NFA accepts a word. So this is nothing but the proof. This is nothing but the proof to your second part of the theorem, that is NFA accepts a word or not is also a recursive. Means once it is a recursive, means we can say that it is nothing but your decidability problems. Getting this point? So two theorems we have proved here successfully. So see it once again. What is the problem theorem statement? Theorem is that we have to prove the following decision problems are recursive. And which are the two problems given here? The two DFAs are equivalent or not. So here we have taken the two Turing machine and we have find out the strings. We have found out the string in a such a way that for Turing machine 1, Turing machine 2, right? And we have taken the intersection of these two Turing machines. That is, first is accepted and second is rejected. And S1 we have calculated the same way. We have find out the S2 string for the rejection by Turing machine 1 and accepted by Turing machine 2. And if we take union of S1 and S2, and if we get the empty string, or if we get as a phi, then we can say that yes, the problem is recursive in nature. The problem, the two DFA are equivalent or not, it is a recursive problem. It is a recursive problem. And for the second one, NFA accepts a word or not. So we have considered the NFA, convert this NFA into DFA, and accordingly, we show that this NFA accepts a word or not is the kind of recursive problem. And once it is a recursive in nature, then we can say that it is nothing but your decidability problems. Getting this point? Now, this is all about your decidability problems concerning with the regular language. Now, because it is why we have considered the DFA and NFA, because we have to prove that the regular languages, they are the kind of decidability problems, right? Regular languages, they are the part of your decidability problems, right? Now, next one. Disability problems concerning with the context-free languages. Now, up till now, we have seen about the regular languages. Now, we have to see about the context-free languages. Or in other words, we can say that the context-free languages, they are also falls under the category of disability problems. Getting this point means, in other words, we can say that our CFL, they are also falls under the category of disability problem. Disability problem means they are solvable in nature. They are solvable in nature. So how to prove this, or how to justify this? Yes, there are some theorems. They are given. So just go through each theorem and their proof. So theorem means they are example or the case study. So first, so the undisability problems about the CFG are whether or not two different context-free languages define the same language, whether given CFL is ambiguous or not, whether complements of the given CFL is a context-free language, and whether the intersection of the two context-free languages is a context-free. There is no algorithm to answer this question. Hence, these problems are known as undecidable problems. Getting this point? So, the undecidable problems for the CFG. So, first, see here, there are undecidable problems given for the context-free grammar. So, first one, whether or not two different context-free languages, CFL, define the same language, that cannot be proved, that cannot be proved with the algorithm. Whether the given CFL is ambiguous or not, whether the context-free language itself is ambiguous, whether the complement of the given CFL is context-free language, that the third one. And the fourth one is that whether the intersection of two context-free languages, CFL1 intersection CFL2, this intersection is a context-free. So these decision or these answers, they are unpredictable or they are undecidable. They are undecidable because there is no algorithm to answer these above four questions. So they are called as undecidable problem. Then which are the decidable problems? So let us see the decidable problems for CFL. So first decidable problems, theorem one, that we have to discuss, that show that the following problem is undecidable. So here, given two CFG, given two context-free grammar G1 and G2, that is language given by G1 intersection language of G2, grammar G2, that is equal to phi, or that is nothing but your empty, that gives you an empty string, right? So how to prove this? So means we have to show the problem is undecidable. So given two CFGs, context-free grammar G1 and G2, capital G1 and capital G2, and their respective languages are language given by grammar G1, and this is the language given by grammar G2. The intersection gives us the empty string. That is nothing but the theorem statement. And to prove this theorem statement, see, step by step, we start doing it. Let capital LG1 and capital LG2 be two CFL. The CFL is not closed under the intersection. CFL is not closed under intersection. The rule is that the context-free language is not closed. So while discussing the property of CFL, while discussing the property of our context-free languages as well as the regular languages, we discussed that they are not closed under the union intersection operation. That means L of G1 means language given by grammar 1, intersection language given by grammar 2 does not necessarily generate the context-free language. Next point, this also implies that there is no algorithm which can tell whether language given by grammar 1, intersection language given by grammar 2, that is equal to empty set. So we conclude that hence it is said that language given by grammar 1, intersection LG2, that is equal to phi, is undecidable. It is undecidable. Getting this point? So how we have proved this? So see here once again. So we have to prove that it is a decidable in nature. LG intersection LG 1 intersection LG2, that is equal to empty string, that is equal to phi. So we have used this particular statement. We have used this particular characteristics of your CFL language. And the characteristic is that CFL is not closed under the intersection operation as well as the union operation. So meaning is that if the language given by grammar G1 and intersection of language given by grammar G2, they does not necessarily generate the context-free language. And that means that, or that implies that, there is no algorithm which can tell whether this particular intersection gives us the empty string. Whether this particular intersection gives us the empty string, meaning is that it is the undecidable one. This is the undecidable one. Getting this point? Let us see the next one. Decidability problems concerning the context-free language. Now let us see the next example or the next theorem. Prove that the CFG, context-free grammar G, generates the string W or not. Means we have to prove that, we have to show that the CFG G generates the string W or not. So for this, proof is written. Convert the CFG G into J dash in the Chomsky normal form, that is CNF, convert it into the Chomsky normal form. Then now the string W belongs to L of G, that is language G, if and only if W can be derived in 2W minus 1 step. It must be derived in 2W minus 1 steps, where none of the intermediate string is the length more than W. So where W is nothing but the length of the string. Suppose the string is like this, AAA, the string length is 3. So 2W minus 1 is equal to 2 into 3 minus 1, that is equal to 6 minus 1, that is equal to 5 steps. So we have to find that if W can be derived, so W, the string must be derived in, so 5 number of steps. It must be derived in the 5 number of steps. Okay. So if these derived steps will derive W, then Turing machine TM accepting language LG will accept, otherwise reject that particular string. So this shows that CFGG generates the string W or not is the recursive one. It is the recursive one. Getting this point? So we have shown that the CFGG generates the string W or not. We have to prove that this is a recursive in nature, so that it is a decidable in nature. So for that we have assumed that, so we take one string W, which is nothing but which is a part of your language generated by the grammar G, if and only if W can be derived in 2W minus 1 steps, means length of the string multiplied by 2 minus 1 steps, where none of the intermediate string is of the length more than W. So if these derived steps will derive W, the Turing machine accepting language given by the grammar G dash will accept it, otherwise it will be rejected. Right? So this shows that CFG or the context-free grammar G generates string W or not is a recursive problem, or it is a recursive in nature. Or as it is a recursive in nature, we can say it is a decidable in nature. It is a decidable in nature, right? Theorem 3, or we'll see the next problem. Let G be a CFG, let G be a context-free grammar, and R be a regular expression. Now it is related with our regular expression RE. Show that the problem LG, the grammar given by the language, is equal to the regular expression for that particular language. So we have to show that first case, the grammar defined by for that particular language, or the language given by the grammar, or the and the language given by the regular expression, and so it is the, so that is they are equal. This is the first proof we have to show it. And the second proof is that language given by the regular expression is belongs to, or it is a subset of the language given by the grammar. These two are undecidable. These two are undecidable. We have to see. Getting the problem or not? So see it once again. The problem is that let G be a CFG, let G be a grammar or context-free grammar, and R be, small r, is the regular expression. So we have to show that this particular problem is undecidable. This particular problem is undecidable. And what is the problem? So problem is that the language, we have to consider the language given by the grammar, that is equal to the language given by the regular expression. First thing means the language given by your grammar G, that is equal to language given by the regular expression RE. They are equal, means this language is equal to this language. This is the first one. And the second one is that language given by the regular expression RE, which is belongs to, or it is a subset of language, is a language defined by the grammar G. So both these problems, and the next problem is that both these problems are undecidable. Both these problems are undecidable in nature, that we have to prove. So how it is being proved, let us see step by step. Okay, so do not get confused. There is no difficulty. Just you have to go through it once or twice so that it will be clear to all of you. Just observe it, listen it carefully and see how the theorems are proved here. So first, let LG, that is the language defined by the grammar, is a context-free language, and LR represents a regular language, right? So because definitely the LG is nothing but the language, that is the context-free language, and LR, the language which is given by the regular expression, of course it is a regular language. Remember this point. So this is nothing but your CFL, and this is nothing but your, this is nothing but your RL, regular language, and CFL, and it is asked to show that CFL equal to RL. And in the second case, the RL is a subset of CFL, and both these are undecidable in nature. Now getting the question. Okay, so see here, the post corresponding problem PCP has some instance which becomes a solution. Now what is this PCP? That we'll see in the next session. So for the timing, remember that the post correspondence problem PCP has some instance which becomes a solution for a given language LR, can be accepted by the CFG for CFG for the language given as a LG. It is also possible that there is a no solution instance of PCP. Such an instance is not accepted by CFG. Such as, so PCP instance, it is not being accepted by your context-free grammar. Next point. Thus, there may exist a CFG, context-free grammar, for the language given by the regular expression, or there may not be a context-free grammar for the language given by the regular expression. Getting this point? Means we cannot decide. So hence, we can state that L of G, that is, means your CFL and RL, it is undecidable. Means whether they are equal. What is the problem? Whether CFL is equal to RL. Getting this point? Means whether the grammar or whether language defined by the context-free grammar and the language defined by the regular expression, that is regular language, and the CFL, they are equal. They are equal or not? It is itself, it is undecidable. Getting the problem or not? Means what is to be decidable or not undecidable? This problem is CFL equal to RL. We cannot decide because there may exist CFG. There may exist CFG for regular for the language given by the regular expression. Or there may not be a CFG, context-free grammar, for the language given by your regular expression R. So we cannot predict that, yes, it may be equal to or it may not be equal to. It may be equal to or it may not be equal to. Meaning is that it is totally undecidable. It is totally undecidable in nature. Right? Next one. Now let us see. This LR means language given by regular expression, that is your RL, which is a subset of language given to regular given by the grammar, that is next your context-free language, is undecidable. Means we have to prove that this is undecidable. Means we cannot decide between this thing. So let us see how it is been proved. So let L, language given by the expression R, represents a regular language. Okay, and LG denotes the context-free language, that is okay. So there may be some string of language LR. There may be some string of language L given by your regular expression that are acceptable by grammar G, then we can state that yes, this language L given by your regular expression, that is a regular language, which is a subset which is belongs to your the context-free language, belongs to your context-free language. So, but since these are arbitrary strings, so these strings are arbitrary in nature, they are arbitrary strings, there may be some string of language given by your regular expression which are not acceptable by your, means there are some string they are acceptable, but there are some string they are not acceptable. Hence we say that LR is not, it is not a subset of, or it is not the, belongs to LG, means your regular language, which is not the subset of CFL, that is context free languages. So meaning is that thus it is not possible to determine, it is not possible to decide whether L of R, that is your regular language, is subset of or it is belonging to context-free language, the language given by the grammar. Hence, it is undecidable in nature. Hence, it is also undecidable in nature. We prove this particular problem also. Getting this point. So we have to write down this statement. We have to step by step solve it. And yes, there is a situation that yes, the sum strings, they are belonging to LR. They may be the part of your LG, but sum string, they are not part of the LG. So we cannot decide. So we cannot have this thing is perfectly. We cannot say that it is a subset of LG. So it is undecidable in nature, or we cannot decide it. So problem is undecidable in nature. Getting this point. Next, now the next point in the complexity analysis is nothing but the undecidability. Undecidability, in that undecidability, we have to see the recursive language and the recursively enumerable languages. So what exactly is the recursive language and the recursively enumerable language? That is RE. RE stands for recursively enumerable languages and the recursive languages also. Let us see the concept of undecidability with reference to recursive and recursively enumerable languages. A language is said to be recursive. Okay, the concept which was encountered in the first slide, recursive language means what? If and only if there exists a Turing machine that accepts every string of the language and every string is rejected if it is not belonging to that language. Means in a simple word, recursive language are the languages, they are accepted by your Turing machine. In a simple word, I can say that the languages, those are accepted by the Turing machine, they are called as the recursive languages, and the languages which are not accepted by the Turing, they are rejected by the particular Turing machine, they are not the recursive languages, in a very simple word. A language is recursively enumerable if there exists a Turing machine that accepts every string belonging to that language. Now, recursively enumerable language means there exists a Turing machine such that every string of that particular language is accepted by the Turing machine TM itself. Right? Getting this one. So what is the difference between the recursive language and the recursively enumerable language? So here, in case of recursive language, there exists a Turing machine that accepts every string of the language and every string is rejected if it is not belonging to that particular language. But in case of recursively enumerable language, each and every string is being accepted by that particular Turing machine of that language. It is called as the recursively enumerable language. And if the string does not belong to that language, then it can cause a Turing machine to enter in an infinite loop. If the string is not belonging to that particular language, that is recursively enumerable language, then it is caused the Turing machine to enter into the infinite loop. So what we have to remember, that recursive languages are the languages which are accepted by your Turing machine, right? Just like your finite automata. So for simplicity, for the understanding purpose, I just write here your finite automata. Finite automata means your DFA as well as your NFA. And the language accepted by these automata is nothing but your regular language, right? Then your contacts and your PDA, push down automata. The language accepted by this push down automata, that is nothing but your context free languages. And the Turing machine, the next automata, Turing machine, the language accepted by Turing machine, it is called as the recursive language. Getting this point? And so definitely the grammar is associated with this one, and the here we are calling it as a regular grammar. This is nothing but your context free grammar. Okay, so the grammar, we have the type 3 grammar, means the restrictions are more in this case. They are slightly less restricted in the second case, and in case of Turing machine, there is no restriction for the grammar. So but for the timing, you have to remember the regular languages, they are the languages, they are accepted by your finite automata, that is DFA or NFA, whereas your CFL, they are given by your push down automata. And the recursive languages, they are given by your Turing machine. And recursively enumerable languages, they are also given by your Turing machine. That is a more powerful automata as compared to your PDA, as compared to NFA, DFA, as compared to NPDA and DPDA. Getting this point? Let us see the next point in this topic, undecidability. Hence, broadly, there are three categories of the language. So languages are categorized into three parts. So recursive language, for which the algorithm exists. So we can say that, yes, So as the recursive languages, they are given by your Turing machine. So we can say that the algorithm exists for the recursive language. Then recursively enumerable language, for which it is not sure that on which input the TM will ever halt, such languages are not in recursive in nature. So the second category is nothing but the recursively enumerable language. And the third category of the language is non-recursively enumerable languages, non-recursively enumerable languages, for which there is no Turing machine at all. For this, no Turing machine at all. So here we can say 100% Turing machine is there. So 50% strings are accepted by the Turing machine, and on some input string, the Turing machine will halt in the for the recursively enumerable languages, because in recursively enumerable languages there are some strings. For such strings, the Turing machine enters into the halt state. That's why they are called as recursively enumerable languages. And the third category of the language is nothing but your non-recursively enumerable language, where the Turing machine will not going to accept the non-recursively enumerable language at all. Getting this point? So the diagrammatically it can be shown like this. So see here, the recursive language in the innermost part, then you have the recursively enumerable and the non-recursive language, and the non-recursively enumerable language, non-recursively enumerable language. So this is at the outer part of that particular figure. So you have the, you can say that non-recursive language, it consists of your recursively enumerable as well as the non-recursive language and the recursive language also. So recursive language, you can have the Turing machine accepted. Here the 50% of the language is accepted by the Turing machine, and the 50% for the 50% language, the TM enters into the halt state. But whereas in case of non-recursively enumerable language, no Turing machine is available to detect this particular language. Getting this point? So okay, so in this session we have studied about the computational complexity. So what exactly is the complexity, computational complexity, how to define the decidability problems concerning the regular language, and the decidability problems concerning the context free languages that we have seen. So these topics we have covered, the decidability means what, the means what, the definition of the disability, how it is expressed. Then disability problems concerning the regular language. Regular language means they are focused on your finite automata, right? And the decidability problems concerning context-free languages means they are focused on your context-free grammar. So we have seen the grammar 1 and grammar 2. We have to compare it, and using some assumption or using some fundamental concept, we have to prove the theorems which are given in the first case as well as in the second case, that is in case of your CFL and in case of your regular languages. Getting this point? Okay, so let us stop here for this session.